Our own lives inspire. welcome you. Wherever you come from, we welcome you. Whomever you love, we welcome you.
Good morning, everyone. I am Robyn Perry, and I will be presenting service today along with Susan Rogers. Lisa Merrill Price and Kevin McLooney are providing technical assistance at home, but we're actually all at home today due to snowy roads, which Kevin said earlier in the chat is actually kind of a benefit of us doing this on Zoom. So maybe in the future, even when we can get together in person, if we have bad weather, we can keep doing our services on Zoom. Thank you all so much for tuning in today. We are glad that we can keep in touch and support our community, even if we can't be together in person. Please be aware we are recording the service and it will be posted on our Facebook and YouTube pages. We joined together this morning to seek justice, equality, and fairness in the world. Our hearts are touched by the human need we feel around us, whether far away or within reach of our hands. We come here to be together because this is how we believe our lives are best lived, in questioning and in conversation, in compassion and in service, in gratitude and in joy, in companionship and in love. It is good to be together with you this morning. Please take a moment to think of all your friends at MVUUC, greet them with a comment in the chat box, and remember that you can still reach out to them via email, phone, social media, or video chat. Physical distancing does not need to mean emotional distancing. Let us support one another. Visitors, as we are a diverse group with varying interests and beliefs, our services are varied in format, tone, and topic. We encourage you to view several services to gain a good understanding of our congregation. If you'd like to receive our weekly email newsletter, please email us at news@mvuuc.org. That's news@mvuuc.org. MVUUC remains committed to supporting our members and friends during this difficult time of social distancing. For that reason, we are coordinating assistance with groceries, phone calls, and other needs. If this sounds like something that would be helpful to you, please send an email to sac@mvuuc.org with your name and what kind of assistance you would like to request. Now is the time for announcements. Announcements can be sent ahead of time to services@mvuuc.org to be read. That's services@mvuuc.org. If you have an important announcement now, you can raise your hand by clicking the raise hand button at the bottom of the, I believe it's in the reactions button now actually, on Zoom. Then we will announce your name and turn on your mic and camera so you can make your announcement yourself. Lisa, are there any announcements today?
Yes, we have a couple of announcements from Megan Rancier. The Anti-Racism Book Club is this Thursday evening, February 4th at 7 p.m., and it will be via Zoom. Email her at sac@mvuuc.org to get more information and to join the book club. And just so everybody knows, you don't have to read the whole book at once. They tend to read a chapter or two and then discuss that chapter and then go to the next. So it's not a requirement to have read the entire book in order to go to the meetings. I also have a announcement from Winnie. The Spirit in Practice group does not meet today, but it will meet next Sunday, February 7th at 1 p.m. for the last workshop. If you have any questions, you can contact Winnie Rex at winrexx@gmail.com, and we'll get that email address into the chat box as well for you. Also, our social action for February will be supporting the Wood County Humane Society. And if you look at the MVUC newsletter, you can get more information on how and what to donate. I know there's also a link in there to, if you like to do the Amazon wish list for them, you can do that as well. So check that out in the newsletter. And then there's one more. Susan has an announcement about yoga. Hold on, Susan.
Yep, I am here. Hi, everybody. I know that many of us are doing a lot of sitting at home, and I'm finally in a place where I can do some yoga during the week. I'm thinking about a class that might be about 30 minutes long, two or three times a week. I can't do floor exercises because the camera doesn't capture me, but I can do standing yoga, which will basically be, you know, stretching while standing up, marching in place, doing different, working the arms and legs and things like that, breathing, maybe doing some chair yoga. So if you're interested in joining me, we'll figure out what dates and what times work for people best. Send me an email. My email address is skrogers777@gmail.com. And if somebody would mind typing that into chat, that would be great. Send me an email. I'll figure out what's the best dates and times for everybody. And let's just at least get moving so that when we can get back together and do a yoga class, we're not squeaking with our joints, right? So thanks.
All right. And the chalice will be lit today by Susan Rogers as well. So please join me in reading the words for the chalice lighting that appear as a comment in the box. Come into this circle of caring. We light this chalice as a beacon of hope, a sign of our listening, and a quest for clearer understandings of ourselves and others. We honored our shared moments in life. And now, Lynn Israel will lead us in a song, Here We Have Gathered.
We who now
So this week's opening words come from Priya Parker's 2018 book, The Art of Gathering, How We Meet and Why It Matters. The way we gather matters. Gatherings consume our days and help determine the kind of world we live in both our intimate and public realms. Gathering, the conscious bringing together of people for a reason, shapes the way we think, feel, and make sense of our world. Lawgivers have understood, perhaps as well as anyone, the power inherent in gatherings. In democracies, the freedom to assemble is one of the foundational rights granted to every individual. In countries descending into authoritarianism, one of the first things to go is the right to assemble. Why? Because of what can happen when people come together, exchange information, inspire one another, test our new ways of being together. And yet most of us spend very little time thinking about the actual ways in which we gather. We spend our lives gathering, first in our families, then in neighborhoods and playgroups, schools and churches, and then in meetings, weddings, town halls, conferences, birthday parties, product launches, board meetings, class and family reunions, dinner parties, trade fairs, and funerals. And we spend much of that time in uninspiring, underwhelming moments that fail to capture us, change us in any way, or connect us to one another. However, I would say that that is not the case for NVUC's previous gatherings and our Zoom gatherings now. Any number of studies support the notion that's obvious to many of us. Much of the time we spend in gatherings with other people disappoints us. With the occasional exception, my mood in conferences usually swings between boredom, despair, and rage. Duncan Green, a blogger and specialist in international development, confesses in The Guardian. Green's take isn't unique to conferences. The 2015 State of Enterprise Work Survey found that wasteful meetings were employees' top obstacle to getting work done. However, reading this from 2018 and 2021, perhaps our perception of boring work meetings will change a little bit, after the COVID-19 pandemic is over. We don't even seem to be, my phone decided to lose my place. We don't even seem to be thrilled with the time we spend with our friends. In a 2013 study, the State of Friendship in America 2013, A Crisis of Confidence, found that 75% of respondents were unsatisfied with those relationships. Meanwhile, in How We Gather, a recent report on the spiritual life of young people, Angie Thurston and Casper Tukuli writes, as traditional religion struggles to attract young people, millennials are looking elsewhere with increasing urgency. As much as our gatherings disappoint us, we tend to keep gathering in the same tired ways. Most of us remain on autopilot when we bring people together, following stale formulas, hoping that the chemistry of a good meeting, conference, or party will somehow take care of itself. The thrilling results will magically emerge from the usual staid inputs. It is almost always a vain hope. When we do seek out gathering advice, we almost always turn to those who are focused on the mechanics of gathering. Chefs, etiquette experts, floral artists, event planners. By doing so, we inadvertently shrink a human challenge down to a logistical one. We reduce the question of what to do with people to a question of what to do about things. PowerPoints, invitations, AV equipment, cutlery, refreshments. We are tempted to focus on the stuff of gatherings because we believe that those are the only details we can control. I believe that's both short-sighted and a misunderstanding about what actually makes a group connect and a gathering matter. Why do we gather? We gather to solve problems we can't solve on our own. We gather to celebrate, to mourn, and to mark transitions. We gather to make decisions. We gather because we need one another. We gather to show strength. We gather to honor and acknowledge. We gather to build companies and schools and neighborhoods. We gather to welcome, and we gather to say goodbye. But here is the great paradox of gathering. There are so many good reasons for coming together that often we don't know precisely why we are doing so. You are not alone if you skip the first step in convening people meaningfully, committing to a bold, sharp purpose. When we skip this step, We often let old or faulty assumptions about why we gather dictate the form of our gatherings. We end up gathering in ways that don't serve us or not connecting when we ought to. In our offices, we spend our days in back-to-back meetings, many of which could be replaced with an email or a 10-minute stand-up meeting. In college, we stare at the floor in lecture halls when the same facts could be better conveyed via video. And I thought that this hadn't aged very well now that we're in past 2020, but that's okay. And the professor's time would be better spent coaching students on specific difficulties with the material. In the nonprofit world, it is customary to throw galas for causes because that is what nonprofits do, even if they don't raise much more money than these galas cost. And yet at moments when we could benefit from gathering to determine how to make a neighborhood park safe again, to strategize with a friend and think through ways to help her struggling career, to rebuild focus after a particularly brutal sales cycle, we don't think together or are too busy to, or in the modern way, we don't want to ask people for their time. So widespread is this desire not to impose that a growing number of people report not wanting a funeral when they die. In short, our thinking about gathering, when we gather and why, has become muddled. When we do gather, we too often use a template of gathering, what we assume a gathering should look like, to substitute for our thinking. The art of gathering begins with a purpose. When should we gather and why?
Is but a song we sing, fears we will die. You can make mountains ring, or make the angels cry. Though the bird is on the wing, and you may not know why. Smile on your brother, everybody get together. Try to love one another right now. Some may come and some may go. He will surely pay his. When the one that left us here turns for us at least, we are but a moment's sunlight fading in the grass. Come on, people now, smile on your brother, everybody get together, try to love one another. Try to love one another right now. Come on, people now, smile on your brother, everybody get together, try to love one another right now. Thank you. If you hear the song I sing, you will understand. Listen. You hold the key to love and fear, all in your trembling hand. Just one key unlocks them both. It's there at your command. Come on, people now, smile on your brother. Everybody get together. Try to love one another right now. Come on, people now, smile on your brother. Everybody get together.
Okay, that is definitely like one of my favorite songs of all time. And I definitely wanted that to play there. And you'll hear a couple of more later on. So I will now start on my reflection portion. When I was in my senior year of high school, I took European history with Mrs. Calvert. This class was one of the very few cases I've ever had of my mind drifting off during her lectures. This wasn't necessarily because she was a bad teacher or she was a boring lecturer. She just had so many cool things hanging on her classroom walls and piled all over the floor and other various surfaces all over her classroom. Mrs. Calvert was a very kind and petite old hippie with short gray hair who taught government, was involved with the culinary arts program on campus, and was the head of the recycling club. She had taught at my high school for so long that she had one of the biggest classrooms on campus that had its very own sink, a microwave, and about a medium-sized refrigerator that she would keep stocked with extra meals, just in case any students came to school without lunches. There was also a separate room that was kind of like a sunroom, a kind of closet deal that she used to store books primarily for the culinary arts program. Sometimes she would let me go into this little closet and just stare at all of the textbooks about cooking and all the cookbooks she had had. And one of the gifts she actually gave me was a presidential cookbook that had a bunch of recipes from the different White House chefs and sometimes the first ladies. And I was able to tell how old this book was and how long she had had it because the last president it went up to was Richard Nixon. And there was an insert for Gerald Ford. So that's how long that thing had probably been sitting in that classroom. So although she was a social studies teacher, Mrs. Calvert had decades of different styles and types of posters and stickers all over her classroom. This included a map of the world that still had the Soviet Union on it, the US presidents. This one was updated. It went up to the president that was, you know, the modern one at the time, not Richard Nixon. Maps and posters of the solar system, the weather cycle, how to and the benefits of recycling, and ones with various quotes on them, such as love people, cook them tasty food, which I actually recently learned actually for preparing for the service, that's actually a brand motto, which I never knew. I've seen it on a bunch of like cute hippie bumper stickers and stuff. And that's actually become somewhat of a personal motto of my own. So the poster that struck me the most was a very 1990s looking one that had a beautiful illustrated border that showed a bunch of people just existing together and doing cool things. Doing what seems to be talking, hanging out in windows and talking to one another, working, planting, and playing in a neighborhood with a lot of green space and blue skies full of sun rays. As you can see from this poster on this PowerPoint, it's just a really beautiful thing that, you know, has birds and people are sitting under apple trees. And sometimes this was more fun to look at than being lectured to in a high school history class. But it wasn't, looking at this poster always transported me away to this fun and lovely looking world. It wasn't just the drawing, the edge on the poster that drew me in. It was also what it said. It was almost a step-by-step instruction manual. This poster, entitled How to Build Community, listed the following suggestions. Turn off your TV. Leave your house. Know your neighbors. Greet people. Look up when you're walking. Sit on your stoop. Plant flowers. Use your library. Play together. Buy from local merchants. Share what you have. Help a lost dog. Take children to the park. Honor elders. Support neighborhood schools. Fix it, even if you didn't break it. Have potlucks. Garden together. Pick up litter. Read stories aloud. Dance in the street. Talk to the mail carrier. Listen to the birds. Put up a swing. Help carry something heavy. Barter for your goods. Start a tradition. Ask a question. Hire young people for odd jobs. Organize a block party. Bake extra and share. Ask for help when you need it. Open your shades. Sing together. Share your skills. Take back the night. Turn up the music. Turn down the music. Listen before you react to anger. Mediate a conflict. Seek to understand. Learn from new and uncomfortable angles. Know that no one is silent, though many are not heard. Work to change this. When I first read this poster in high school, I figured this had to be about some magical, fantastical place that was too good to be true, not the world I was living in. At this time, I lived a 10-minute walk from my school and essentially only ever went in between those two places. While we did know our neighbors, it was just because they had lived next to my parents for about 15 years. My parents had no friends or community of their own. They simply went to work, came home, watched TV, and then went to bed. I also lived in a city of about 250,000 people that were spread out over 70 square miles, so it was not very easy to build a community when I was a teenager with no car. About 5 years later, I moved to Bowling Green. After a few months of living on campus, spending countless hours a day in the history department, and only going out to get groceries, I decided I needed to branch out for my own sanity. That's when I found MVUUC. Having been at MVUUC for a little over a year now, paired with this congregation, I have now done almost everything on this building community poster, or have at least done things that are similar or related. We together have turned off our TVs and left our electronics behind, left the house, got to know and greeted one another, played together through laughter yoga and gaming groups, shared what we have a playground for kids behind the church. We honor our elders, help our neighborhood, fix things, garden together, read stories, help each other, ask for help, have started traditions, have baked extra and shared at our potlucks, and opened up the shades. We have sung together, we have shared our skills, turned up the music, turned down the music, listened, we have sought to understand, learned from different angles, and have worked to make sure everyone's voice is heard. While we all now may be reminiscing about the time just about a year ago when we could physically get together and do all of these wonderful community activities together, don't worry. Syracuse Cultural Workers, which is the organization that made this original poster back in 1996, has something to help us out now too. Last year, they came up with an updated version of this old poster for building community during a pandemic. We're all in this together, so we should take a deep breath and give thanks for a new day. Remember, we are part of a large, diverse, global community. Find safe ways to check on neighbors, sing with them, practice physical distancing, wash your hands, limit touching your face, go outside and get moving, use gloves to pick up trash, wear a mask to protect others, greet folks as you pass them, read aloud to each other and to children, take a break from the news. Let me repeat that one. Take a break from the news. Use technology to nourish social connections. Reach out to old friends. Make amends. Organize for local elections, unions, and grassroots power. Imagine a shared future for people, plants, and animals. Remember to grieve. Make room for a new normal. Protect and assist vulnerable people. Offer help if you can. Share toilet paper. Ask for support when you need it. Cherish and maintain reduced pollution. Support local farms and food pantries. Eat healthy food. Buy from local businesses. Tap into your creativity. Try something new. Send letters, postcards, and packages. Make and share music. Dance like the world is watching. Thank and support essential workers, healthcare, sanitation, postal, food, and many others. And once again, repeat it, know that no one is silent, though many are not heard. Work to fix this. And this is exactly what we have been doing. While this pandemic is definitely hard on many of us, there have been some silver linings. We've enjoyed building and harvesting from MVUC's new community garden as of this past spring, and a group of us are already planning for this upcoming spring. We've had digital game nights. We continue to have socially distanced Sunday services via Zoom, like we're doing right now. And if it weren't for these Zoom services, we probably wouldn't even have service this morning because of all the snow. We spent more times with family and roommates and learned how important this is. I don't know about you all, but I've gotten more mail from friends in the past year than I ever have. We've all delved into our creative sides a bit, and some of us have even shared with the rest of us here at MVUC that through mediums as diverse as gardening, singing, playing musical instruments, videography, embroidery, and storytelling. This past year has been rough for all of us, and in a different way for every single one of us here. Fortunately, I personally think we at MVUC have been doing a great job of building and maintaining our community during this time. We've been utilizing quite a lot of these suggestions that Syracuse Cultural Workers poster have suggested, and we didn't even know it. And I bet you didn't even know that we have the original How to Build Community poster hanging in the religious education room. When I first saw that about 6 months ago, it all came together and made MVUC make so much more sense to me. I know it's hard, but let's keep our spirits high. Spring will be here soon. Seeds for this year's garden are already on their way. Hannah has been doing some ordering, and I know she's very excited about that. Keep physical distancing, keep washing your hands, and keep wearing a mask. Remember to breathe, remember to take breaks, exercise, go outside, and take a break from the news. I will yell that at everybody. Take a break from the news and read, not the news, read other things that you don't have to. Keep tapping into your creativity and keep eating well. Keep having Zoom happy hours with family, friends, and coworkers. With vaccines already being given, hopefully we'll be able to get together again soon, and we'll keep building our community in ways we did before, while also utilizing some of the new methods we've had to learn and embrace during the past year. If you need more information about vaccines, we do have some in the newsletter for this past week. So let us just keep a positive outlook towards the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Robyn. That was wonderful. We'd love to hear from you more often during presentations. You always bring such good ideas. So of the 7 UU principles, only number 6 mentions the word community or uses the word community. A world community focused on peace, liberty, and justice for all. So the suggestions in these posters certainly include actions that would meet the goals of peace, liberty, and justice on a global scale and a local scale, such as supporting local elections, unions, and grassroots power, supporting local businesses, farmers, and food pantries, and certainly by assisting vulnerable people. And I think many of the actions on both posters are also supportive of UU principle number 7, which is the respect for the interdependent web of all existence of which we are a part. So understanding how to treat the earth by planting trees and flowers, planting gardens, picking up trash while, of course, wearing protective gloves, getting to know your neighbors and checking on them, especially if they're elderly, and finding ways, your own ways, to reduce pollution by doing things like recycling. But to me, ultimately, all the suggestions on these two posters support UU principle number one, the inherent worth and dignity of every person. Each and every person is important in this world, including yourself. Washing our hands, physical distancing, wearing masks is a sign of respect for other people's health and welfare. Checking on them, reaching out, sharing with them, singing, Zooming, honoring the elderly, thanking people are not only good, but it's good for us as well. A recent study published by three major universities said that places where residents stick together on a more community and social level appear to do a better job of helping people in general to live longer. So attending MVUUC is not only fun and informative, it also may be helping all of us live a longer, healthier, and happier life. So now more than ever, we are counting on your and donations to help us sustain and strengthen this congregation that is so important to all of us, supporting our efforts to be a community of love and truth and justice and service. So please click on the link in the chat box or scan the QR code and be sure to select the correct designation on the drop-down box when you donate. Thank you.
All right, I will be summing us up with some closing words. Communities play an important role in every aspect of our lives. We have community in our friends, our families, our employment, our neighborhoods, and in so many other places. We find community in the sports teams we support or the artists we enjoy